So, welcome to the Milestone Driver Framework and MIP SDK Tips and Tricks presentation from Orbnet Systems. So, firstly, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank Milestone and the team for allowing Orbnet Systems, that's Eric Bork and myself, Edward Cutts, to present at DEFCON 2020. Now, I've had the privilege of attending this event for the last 2 years in Copenhagen, and I'm very happy to again be able to take part, this time from the community side. So let's just look at what we're going to do today, what we're going to cover. So in our session, we have a very quick introduction, who we are and what we do as Orbnet. Then we're going to go into Eric's experience with the driver framework. He'll explain the goal and how we worked with the driver framework and show you the results that we have obtained. Then we'll go into the SDK tips and tricks, and this is just how Eric speeds up his development and debugs his plugins. And finally, we'll have a very quick live presentation, a live question and answer session. So, who are Orbnet Systems? The initial idea to create Orbnet, it all stemmed from the Milestone MIP SDK. Now, I worked with Milestone for almost 9 years, and in that time, I always saw the MIP SDK as the key component in enabling large project wins. I often had to work with multiple vendors as we delivered a Milestone solution to the end customer. Now, I'd heard of Eric through his work in relation to the Milestone Kickstarter competitions in 2018 and 2019, 2018 being the alarm server that he presented at MIPS Vegas, and that is now an Orbnet product in its own right, available on the Milestone Marketplace, and then again at 2019 in Copenhagen. Now, neither of those times did Eric's software actually win the Kickstarter, however, for myself, it was definitely a win in that it enabled the starting of Orbnet Systems. Now, in the short time that Eric and I have been working together, we've already delivered some very large projects, key wins for both Milestone and for Orbnet Systems. Now, today, Eric is going to show some of the work he's completed in relation to the new driver framework. This has opened many new doors for Orbnet and for Milestone. And in this example, we're going to show we were approached by IBM and asked to work with their analytics software and make their results viewable in Milestone. Now, the driver framework, as you will see, allows us to take the metadata around the analytic detections in IBM and present them in the Milestone Smart Client in a completely new way. This allows live detections to be seen in real time and also be able to search on previous detections from the very same window. So once again, in my opinion and experience, 90% of the large-scale Milestone projects require integration and development. So this is a huge sector for the Milestone community at large to be involved in. And today we want to show you some of the development strides we've taken in working with the MIP SDK and in this instance, the driver framework. So what was our remit? So this was the initial goal and requirements, basically to integrate IBM Analytics into Milestone. There was already an integration as such in that IBM were able to work with the Milestone mobile server and take the video out and then work with the analytics in their front end. But they recognized that there's a lot more power if they can bring those events back in and display them in the Milestone Smart Client. So that was their initial reason for contacting Orbnet. They needed to avoid using extra channels to keep this cost down for their customers, because if a camera's already being recorded to Milestone, why do they have to pay it again, potentially? They also need to make it easy to use and maintain. And finally, and really key to this project, was around the speed of development. We had to be able to create the solution as quickly as possible and also create a proof of concept as quickly as possible. So how does our system look? So from a very high level, these are the components. We had to get to know the IBM engine. So the IBM had three components that we had to understand. We had to understand their DLE, or their deep learning engine, their SSE, or semantic streams engine, and their MILS, the metadata ingestion, lookup, and signaling engine. Orbnet then have a piece of software already. Eric had developed an RTSP server that's able to pull the live and or recorded video from Milestone and then feed it into IBM for them to do the detections. At that point, Eric is able to use the Orbnet driver, which is based on the driver framework, to then retrieve the metadata detections and then pass these through to a new display vector that we've created in the Smart Client called the Orbnet Metadata Search. So that is a high level of how we're integrating Milestone components into IBM But then the key piece is bringing that back into Milestone so that everything is then shown in the smart client. So that's the quick overview. I'll now pass on to Eric, who will go through the rest of this presentation. So thank you very much.
Hello, everyone, and thanks for the intro, Eddie. So now I'm going to split this presentation into two parts. In the first part, I'm going to continue talking about the framework driver and how you can get it to work with the H.264 and H.265 protocols, as well as how to send metadata into it. In the second part, I will talk about some useful tools we use in every SDK project that I would have really benefited from knowing when I started about 6 years ago. So let's get right into it. Our biggest challenge was sending the video frames into the driver so that it would be displayed properly. The demo driver example in the SDK already lets you receive motion JPEG frames, so that's a good place to start. If we wanted to do a minimalistic integration, we could have simply combined the demo driver example with the media live viewer sample. The media live viewer sample lets you extract JPEG frames from any camera connected to the recording server using the JPEG live source class. When the framework driver starts, it would start an instance of JPEG live source using a camera GUID as a parameter and send all the JPEG frames into a buffer. The driver framework would empty this buffer as fast as you could fill it, and you would have video. The solution is pretty easy to implement, but it comes at a cost. Firstly, if you want to use the H.264 or H.265, the stream will have to be decoded, which requires a lot of processing. In our initial tests, we turned the media live viewer sample into a service to get the frames, and as expected, it would not scale very well. Secondly, if you were copying a stream, you end up with an extra channel to license, and you need to record that extra channel if you want the metadata to be recorded. This means you have to record the extra motion JPEG stream, which is going to fill up your disks very fast and also put a big load on the network. So what other options did we have? Luckily for us, we had already done an integration that uses the raw live source instead of the JPEG live source. This means we could get the raw data from the recording server, and it looks like this. Can you see the pattern? Each line is a hex representation of a Milestone video frame. More specifically, it's an H.264 video frame because the value of the 8th byte is 0.8. Once you sort out which ones are the iframes and pframes, you can assemble them together into an array of frames that Milestone can use. Milestone uses a structured format, which is essentially the raw video coming from the camera with a Milestone header on it. If you format the video with this header, Milestone will be able to read it. For a video source, you need to specify the sequence number, codec, timestamp, and the total length. So now we've solved 90% of our problems, but we still have one. We are still required to copy a stream from another device if we want to get the video in the new driver. So what did we do? The next step in our adventure was to get the video streams directly from the cameras themselves, so that we don't need to double up all the channels we want to use for analytics. Little did we know, this would prove to be quite the challenge for us. Most cameras can output an RTSP stream, so we decided to start there. RTSP stands for Real-Time Streaming Protocol, or more officially known as RFC-2326. RFC-2326 is a protocol that counts several hundred pages, if you count the H.264 and H.265 variants. It's a very, very big protocol. Although it is pretty complex, once we're able to receive the stream from the camera, all we have to do is reuse the timestamps that we can extract and reassemble the video frame so that the driver framework would be able to ingest them. The hard part is the actual connection to the camera. The RTSP connection sequence is very specific, and a single error will cause a lot of havoc. This is where you can really appreciate all the work that Milestone has done on their device packs. Each camera vendor may implement RTSP slightly differently, and the only way to guarantee functionality is to test with as many different cameras as possible. It's easier to just reuse the data that Milestone provides, even though that would require an additional channel for analytics stream. Thankfully, protocols like ONVIF exist to make video and audio over RTSP a bit more predictable, but again, there can be surprises. Basically, it comes down to watching this little bit several times a second. When its value is 1, it means you can assemble all the RTSP packets that came before it into a single video frame. So after a few weeks of trial and error, of figuring out exactly how RTSP works, we are now equipped with a stable framework driver that can ingest streams from a wide variety of cameras. By simply adding the whole RTSP URL as a parameter of the channel, we named this new driver the Orb Streamer. Now, how do we start sending metadata into the Orb Streamer so that we can see those glorious bounding boxes appear inside the smart client? Metadata. Once you get all the video streaming out of the way, the fun part is bringing in the analytics. All you need to do is send a standardized ONVIF metadata XML file in the metadata channel of your framework driver. This XML file can contain all the information you see here. For our project, we selected a subset of these components as we did not have the requirement for behaviors and navigational data. For metadata to display correctly in the smart client, you must first make sure you get the UTC time of the metadata frame. If your metadata source is almost real time, you can simply use the local UTC time that you get when you receive the event. If your metadata source takes a while to process the video feed, you will have to make sure your machine is in sync with the source and convert the local timestamp you're receiving into universal standard time. The transformation and shape is what is used to position the bounding box inside the image. You must make sure that you convert whatever coordinate system you're using to the ONVIF coordinate system, which I will explain later. The ONVIF object ID is used to identify the object. If you want to display several bounding boxes in one frame, you must make sure each object has a different ID. The ID can also be used to track an identity across several frames. For example, if your metadata source can identify a person based on their clothes and color, you can, in theory, generate an ID based on these characteristics and use it to follow someone across several different cameras. And finally, this is the display text that will show over the bounding box. When we started this project, we asked IBM if they could send us a stream of the analytics data they were generating in real time. They provided us with an REST server that outputs raw metadata and JSON format for all their channels combined. We decided to have each metadata channel connect to the REST server and filter out the detections that had a corresponding channel ID. We had to go through the painstaking process of parsing all this data, and this is what we had to work with. This is what a JSON from IBM looks like. We can see the channel number is 2. It's running object detection using AI. There is a detected person and a detected bicycle. And we can see the bounding box information as well as the score. There is a single timestamp for the whole image for all these detections, so we know that all these objects belong to the same image. All that was left at this point was to implement an algorithm that converts the IBM bounding box, which is in pixel coordinates, into the ONVIF metadata coordinates, which goes from -1 to 1. So we used a bit of simple math to calculate the coordinates of the four corners in ONVIF space. With all the data ready, we can serialize our strongly typed class into an XML file, making sure that all the tags are properly formatted, and send it into the driver. The resulting XML file looks like this. These are the coordinates of our bounding box. Here we can choose the fill color of the bounding box, which looks really good if you give it a slight transparent gray value. The line color, which is the bounding box itself. Notice you can set the thickness as well as the color. And finally, we have the description, which is the text box that is overlaid on the bounding box. The X and Y values would need to be calculated so that the text does not escape the bounds of the image. You can set the color and the font of the text. In our case, we use the color to separate the alarm metadata from the information metadata. So let's quickly go over the framework driver properties. If you want to add several framework drivers, each of them must have a unique MAC address. For our driver, instead of putting an IP address and port in the newly add camera menu, well, we use that menu to put in the MAC address. So once you get the new driver, it uses that MAC address. Once our driver appears in the list, the hardware parameters allows us to set the IP, username, and password to connect to the IBM Analytics server. That's the REST server we were talking about. We use the confidence score that we get with the JSON data to determine if we should trigger a custom event or just show the bounding boxes as information. We've also added a Boolean value to trigger random metadata. This is useful for debugging and choosing the colors before going live. We added some metadata channel parameters so that users can change the color of the bounding boxes and specify which colors correspond to alerts and which ones are purely informative. The IBM channel number allows us to filter out the metadata for a particular channel, and the detection width and height is used to convert the IBM detection coordinates to the on-bit coordinates. So, this is the fun part. These are the initial tests that we did when we were getting the driver off the ground. So, we started by using stable FPS to get the video feed from. We did most of our tests with a 60 frame per second H.265 video in 4K. So that's pretty demanding. And we know that once we were able to work with that, any other streams would be easy. And we set our metadata random generator to true so that it'll show some bounding boxes all over the place. And so what you see here on the top is the stable FPS driver, and at the bottom is our orb streamer driver. So start the video. You can see here I'm switching the stable FPS frame rate from 300, from 60 to 300. And this is going through our RTSP server, so we're taking the stream out of Milestone as RTSP and then back into our orb streamer. And yeah, these are the results. So we can see we're getting pretty much 300 frames a second. And it's giving a pretty good run at our graphics card here. You can see that the 280 Ti we're using is getting pretty hot. All right, now for some real-world results. We decided to run our system against a very demanding video. We can see here we're starting up the smart client. So again, we're using stable FPS to get some video. And we use a traffic camera that's in a very highly populated area with a lot of bicycles. I'll just pause the video here for a second so you can see what's going on. So in the Milestone server, we have the stable FPS driver. Our RTSP server, which works a lot like the on-bit bridge, is able to send the video out of Milestone to be processed by the IBM servers. And the IBM server is sending us back all the data with the JSON REST server. Now, our orb streamer is also connecting to that stable FPS driver, but it could also connect to any standard camera. So if I run the video, we can see that all the bounding boxes are being displayed correctly onto the smart client image live, and we decided to push the integration one step further. So you can see there's a lot going on here, but basically, the part that you see under the camera, this is our integration for visualizing metadata. There's a place where we can select the start time and the end time, and depending on how long that is, if it's minutes, hours, or days, it'll be able to go and get all the metadata, and it'll color code it. So in this example, the blue areas are people, the green ones are cars, red is a bicycle, and you can go ahead and change all that. We can turn on or off a certain type of detection and change the colors. So now, well, we have everything except people and cars, so this will show all the areas that we have not people and cars. And when we click on the image, we can see, okay, well, there are those things in there, but there's also the ones that aren't. So that being said, we can use this to really see over a long period of time what kind of detections happened in those areas. And if I go a little further down the video, we can see here we're changing our scale from a number of minutes to a number of hours. And so here, for each hour, we have about 23,000 events that are being loaded. So using the metadata classes, we're able to go and pull all the metadata out of the recording server, and it's basically just an XML file, so we go ahead and parse that XML file, and we can see all the different types of detections that happened. And there it is. So from 12 to 13 o'clock, we loaded 23,000 events. From 13 to 14, another 23,000. So yeah, that's a lot of events in there. So now if we switch back from hours to minutes, so I can refresh it, and you'll see now it's starting to load all these events again with the right colors. And since the finish time is later than the actual time, you can see all the metadata, the newly generated metadata, dropping in as time evolves. So if you click on one of those lines, it'll actually bring up the video of the time of the event. So now I can go ahead and put the time scale a little further, and automatically it rescales to show all these events. Hovering the mouse over one of the events on one of the colors will show what that color is. And yeah, so we just did that so that people can actually see what kind of detections they're getting in their drivers. So that's it for part one. Now we're going to look at part two, the SDK tips. So again, these are things that I would have really liked to have if I started off, but I guess some of these things might be useful for people that have been working with Milestone for a long time. So yeah, let's get right into it. So the first thing we're going to look at is the logs. Now, Milestone's default logger works very well, but if you're in an environment where you're trying to build an event server plugin and maybe there's already a whole bunch of other plugins installed on it, let's say they have an access control server, and very often you just want to be able to open up the event server logs and take a look at what's happening, but you have logs from a whole bunch of other plugins, so how could you take your logs and isolate them into your own directory? So there's a trick for this. If you have to remember something from this, take a look at this special folder here. In C#, you can write environment, special folder, local application data. And what this does is that it gives you a folder that you can write to without giving admin privileges. You can create any plugin. As long as you log it inside of that folder, you'll be able to create and delete files in there without needing any special access. So you can see here, if you take the environment manager, we've separated it into three areas. Now, we can see here that we're using the data folder as a static string, so we can access this from anywhere in our code. And depending on what environment it is, it gives off smart client, event server, management client, or app friendly name, which is if you're running a standalone service, but you still connect to Milestone. So now if we go to our logger class, which by the way, all this code is available in our Orbnet license SDK, which you can get freely on GitHub if you want to have access to the code. So our logger class is a static class, you can access it from anywhere. And basically what it does is you have one part throwing everything into a concurrent queue, and you have a thread that's always active that's logging to those files. So we can see while the logger is active, it's taking the file, it's actually gonna add the date time to it, and it's gonna check to delete anything that's older than 30 days. And this will write it to the log, and then the interesting part right here, you can see that when it's logging, so we've had a few overloads to be able to log format, to log an object. If it's an exception, it'll put true in the parameter so that it logs as an exception. And then the interesting part is here. So this logger, you can see that we're getting the stack trace. So what does the stack trace do? It's basically gonna look at where you are in the code so that it'll log the name of the function that you're in. So that could be pretty useful. Now, we're always logging to the environment manager. So this means it's going to do the default logs in Milestone anyways. So then we're taking the string, we're adding the date to it, and yes, in the end, we're adding it to our log queue, and we're also writing it in the console and in the debug so that the logs appear all over the place. So that's how you do custom logs. So that was the first tip. Now the second tip. We want to move a log for the framework driver, but how do we do that? So the problem is with the framework driver, if you log things, it'll log in the same folder for every single driver. So let's say you have five or six channels. How do you make it so that each one of these channels gets logged to a different folder? So we came up with a pretty fun trick, and this is using the thread ID in a dictionary. So what you're doing is basically, every time you initialize your logger, you're checking to see if the thread ID is the same or not. And then if it's a new thread ID, you find a way to link it to that camera. So let's take a look at what we did here. We're starting off in the demo connection manager class. So this is the same class that you have in the framework driver example. Now, when we're creating this class, you're always going to have your own client that connects to your video source. And this is either going to be something getting JPEGs or, in our case, getting H.264 and H.265. So we know that in our container, we're always getting a MAC address because every channel needs to have a unique MAC address. That's a good thing. Now, when we're connecting, we're creating our own video proxy. And in this case, we called it our Orb Streamer client. This is what's handling the connections to all the different streams. And we get one per channel. So if I go in there, we can see that when I start our logger, we start our logger with the MAC address. So let's go into the logger, see what that does. Now this is the trick. So we're taking the MAC address. In this part, we're just making sure that it is a MAC address and it's not weird or anything. And then this is the trick. We're taking the ID of the current thread that we're running on. That means that we started a new channel. We know it's going to be a new thread ID for this channel. So thread ID to MAC, this is basically just a concurrent dictionary. So we're adding this to our concurrent dictionary, sorry. And what's in there, we're just reusing that ID. So why is this clever? Well, it's because we can do our logging without adding an extra parameter each time we want to log something. So you see, it's the same logger as before, just the object. We're not sending any extra parameters, but every time we do the log, we're taking the ID from the thread that we're on, and we're sending that as a parameter to our log queue. You'll see now that our log queue, instead of being just a simple concurrent queue, it's now a concurrent queue with a tuple in it, the int being the thread ID and the string being the message we want to log. And so when our logger picks this up, it dequeues the element, it checks to see if the ID that we got is actually contained in the list. If not, it's just going to log it to a path called mixed. Now, here we are again. It's taking the path and it's adding it into that. So what we end up with is, well, the mixed folder that we had from before. This will just show logs from the connection states of the different drivers. And then for each different MAC address, we have the logs for that channel. And we also went ahead and added an extra one for the metadata. This way, all our logs are separated, and anything that happens, well, we can track it down. Quick tip number three, loading all your plugins into a single DLL. So we can see here, our plugin.dev is using the Smart Client Administration and Service. So how does that work? You'll find this example in many SDK samples, but it's basically by going in the plugin definition class, and then you check the environment manager for which environment type you're loading. So you can see if it's Smart Client, we're adding the appropriate background and side panel plugins. If we're running as administration, we'll create our item nodes to be able to show things in the management client. And then if it's a service, we can have our event server background plugins. Tip number four. Now this one's especially for when you're creating event server plugins and access control plugins. So we found that every time we need to test, we have to stop the event server, copy the files over, and restart the event server. And every time we do this, we're losing a lot of time. So we created our own little installer class that what it does, it'll take a zip file and unzip it somewhere. And then as parameters, you can tell it, well, okay, we want you to stop some processes before you copy the files. So this will stop the smart client, this will stop the management client, and this will kill the event server. We can select some firewall ports to open if we want to create a desktop icon, and even if we want to install the EXE as a service. Now, these other things are kind of bonus, but being able to stop the event server, copy files over, and restart the event server is very useful. We could take a look at what this looks like. So every time we run our installer, we get a quick little console app logging our pretty logo. And then depending on the install options, we can install different components without losing too much time. Now, once your plugin is deployed and you want to send it to one of your clients, perhaps they have a large network and they want to be able to deploy it cleanly and rapidly. Now to avoid these kinds of error messages, nobody likes to see those, you can go ahead and use a professional tool. And this is just an example. There are many others out there. But you can use MCO, which is a paid version. So what it does is that it allows you to load DLLs into it and a whole bunch of different files, tweak registry settings, and then it'll give you an MSI that you can run silently on a network to install things that way. So that's one way you can save a lot of time during development. While I'm on the topic of increasing productivity, there's a little trick you can use to debug smart client applications faster as well. Now, since you're not running in the event server, you could just have a smart client installed on the same machine that you're developing on and have that start up. So how do you do that? First of all, you're going to want to copy the DLLs to the smart client MIP plugins folder. To do that, you simply take the target directory and add *** next to it, and that will copy all the files of your project in your output folder right into where you select on the right. So in this case, Milestone, MIP plugins, Orbnet license SDK. The next thing to do is to go to the debug tab, and we're going to want to start an external program instead of the default start project. And here you're going to navigate to program files, Milestone, smart client, client.exe. And when you debug, it's automatically going to copy the files to the right directory and start the smart client. And now anything you do in the smart client, if you write debug.writeline somewhere, you'll be able to retrieve those logs. Tip number 5, source control. If we're not using it, you're doing something wrong. Let's create a new project here so you can see how easy it is to use source control. Now, you really don't have any excuse not to do it anymore. Some companies still copy and paste their folders every day to create backups. That way, you end up using a lot of storage for nothing, and that's really not practical. So when you create a new project, I'll just create a console app for show. Call it console app 1. That's very good. And once you create it, you can simply go up to the file, add to source control. If you've already logged in, it'll already use your owner, so I can add to my personal account or to our company. And when you add it to the company, you can select if you want to make it private or not. And that's all there is to it. I'm not going to go too much into how GitHub works, but it's just necessary to know that it gives you a nice clean way of managing all your code. You can have everything uploaded securely onto a server. It's the best way to collaborate with other people, to share the code. You can be working locally, and then as long as your source control is up to date, you could just take a laptop and take off to a client site and load your source control, work on it, and then any changes you make will be re-uploaded to the cloud, and so you could just have access to it that way. Another very useful feature of source control is branching and being able to go back in time to a previous version. So these are all the tools that GitHub will give to you. Make sure you use it. It's awesome. So tip number 6, message communication with complex objects. So this is the last tip of the day. If you're building a large plugin that has several different components, so let's say you have a smart client plugin, an event server plugin, and also a management server plugin, you might need to be able to communicate between these parts. Now, one way of doing that is storing data in MIP item objects, which you can save to the SQL. You can access the data that way. But if you want something quicker that doesn't get saved, you can use Milestone's message communications. Now, another way around that would be to implement your own TCP server and client and have that working, but that can be really complex. And you really don't need to do it because Milestone's message communication works great. So what you need to do is you create a class, make sure it's serializable. You have to create the serializer and deserializer for it, just to make sure that you can transform it to binary or XML and then transfer it back from XML or binary to data. And once you get that, you can just call it simply by doing a register communication filter with a channel ID that you select. So make sure it's unique to your application, or else you might get some conflicts with other plugins. And once you have that, you can just send it off like so by transmitting a message with the message communication class and using the data in it. And then when you register to the same channel ID, you'll be able to receive those messages from anywhere within the SDK. So that's it for the presentation. I really hope you enjoyed it, and we're open to some questions now. Ask us anything you like.